I'm Annie Dance. I am an independent investigative journalist working to shine a light on police and policy issues in Western North Carolina and beyond. Here's a photo of me and my dog about 2 summers ago on the Blue Ridge Parkway. I'm going to share some information with you about the upcoming primary election that's really already underway in North Carolina. Please subscribe if you haven't already to anniedance.substack.com, my Cops in Congress newsletter. When you reach the welcome page, if you haven't already become a paid member, you will have the option to do so and choose from various tiers. If you become a paid supporter, you will get access to subscriber-only posts, including the full archive. You'll be able to post comments and join the community. Have, of course, my utmost gratitude and thanks for helping me spread the word to shine a light on these important issues. And if you become an annual member, it's cheaper than monthly. And if you become a founding member, you'll get everything plus a special monthly message of thanks from me. Or if you choose none, you will only have access to public posts. So this is just, again, the different tiers. Occasionally, the public posts will be information that can be easily, readily, publicly accessible. So in other words, I'm not going to charge you for information that, you know, the North Carolina State Board of Elections has on their website that's very prominent. But if there's an investigations piece to that, then that's where I take a deeper dive and deserve to be paid for my time, energy, and efforts to bring those stories to light. If you look back at my prior reporting, you will see the coverage that I've done since the beginning of the 2024 election, and you can click on those various links throughout those stories to help better assist you in your decision on who to vote. I'm not one to endorse a candidate. I believe that's only best suited for people in the political realm. I don't believe in telling people who to vote for. I'm going to aid in your ability on the voting process and getting to the polls. In Lake Lawrence in Rutherford County, North Carolina, if you are a registered voter in Rutherford County, the Rutherford County Board of Elections website has more details and can better assist you. If you have specific details, specific questions, you of course can contact them, and they have various sample ballots and further information about where to vote early and where to vote on primary election day on March 5th. So a programming note: today, Saturday, February 24th, there is no early voting on Saturday today, but there is early voting next Saturday on March 2nd, according to information from the Rutherford County Board of Elections. This document, I had to do some digging on their website to find, and then it made me open it and save it to my computer, etc., which is part of what I do and try to do in my journalism, is show information that's really, it's, I wouldn't call it readily accessible. I would say it takes some digging to get to these public documents. So this document displays the hours, days and hours of when you may vote early in the 2024 primary election. Again, today on February 24th and tomorrow, February 25th, there is no option. There is the polls are open 8 to 7:30 Monday through Friday next week, and again Saturday from 8 to 3, according to this document from the Rutherford County Board of Elections. There are two locations where you may vote early: Isothermal Community College at the Business Sciences Building, the Blue Room in Spindale, or the County Annex Building on Main Street in Rutherfordton. So, for example, I live in Green Hill, and the County Annex building is physically closer. I chose to vote early there. However, I could also go to ICC if I wanted to. You don't have to go to one place or another just because it may physically be closer there. Let's say I was doing errands in Spindale or Forest City, or just wanted to go there for whatever reason I wanted to go there. You are welcome to do that as well. To give you some situational awareness, in Rutherford County, the county commissioners are made up of five individuals, and two of which are up for re-election this year in 2024. And the five people who are the current county commissioners are listed here. The two up for re-election are Greg Lovelace and David Hunt. The other commissioners, as you can see from this document provided by the county, show the other office holders' terms expire in 2026. So keep that in mind, and you can also look at the State Board of Elections website for more information about your polling place search. You can put your address in, or you can also search by precinct. So let's say you want to wait until March 5th to actually go vote. That place, your polling place, will be different than the early voting location in Rutherford County. So just again, situational awareness for the 2022 election. Here were the results for the local races. Let's see. Yeah, all races, and I had it set up a minute ago. Bear with me, just there we go. You see that there were no Democrat opponents for the county commissioners in the 2022 election, and that's why you only see one name on each ballot there. So I found that to be very interesting. And so some of those ballot counts were also very interesting. There's a phenomenon known in some political analyst circles that discuss, why would someone choose just one name basically or skipping your vote? So please, people, remember to vote for every name on the ballot because really every vote does matter and does count, especially in close elections. But this was the November 8th, 2022 election, just to give you a lay of the land of what that looked like. And then again, those county commissioner candidates who are current county commissioner candidates, excuse me, county commissioners are listed here. So on the primary election ballot for 2024, you will see five names for county commissioners. And this website isn't cooperating with me quite as I would have hoped. There you go. So Donnie Hawk, Mark Ledford, and Greg Lovelace for one board seat, and Hunter Haynes and David Hunt for the other. Again, you can view my past reporting for more details about who's on the ballot, but I wanted to share some information. When I attended really the only county commissioner candidate forum that was held earlier this month on February 13th in I guess technically it's Morrow's Borough, but it was on Harris Henrietta Road at a church right near the Second Broad River. So I'm going to play that recording in its entirety. I did not edit the audio in any way, and I really haven't made any edits to the name. So hopefully it's not too difficult to follow along to the conversation. I apologize if there's any audio issues. The service there was a little bit spotty to get accurate audio, but I hope it is helpful to aid in your decision on voting for county commissioners in 20 for the primary in 2024. Just in case it's not obvious, the policy making body, which sets the budget for county operations, is what the county commissioners are. And it doesn't matter which district in which you live, you can vote for both. You'll see on the ballot for both options. Also, just a programming note about that. You do to vote in the primary 2024 election. Again, there are no Democrats on the ballot. Here's some information from my previous reporting. And to better aid you in your decision to vote, please check that out. So who can vote in the primary? Just real quick before I play the recording, I want to highlight this and make sure it's abundantly clear to everyone. If you are a registered voter in North Carolina and you are a registered Democrat, you must select the Democrat ballot in the primary. If you are a registered Republican, you must select the Republican ballot in the primary. If you are a registered unaffiliated voter, meaning you're not a member of either party, you can select any party ballot you would like. And if you are a registered Libertarian, you must select the Libertarian ballot. The North Carolina State Board of Elections lays out all of those rules. Again, if you are an unaffiliated voter, you may select whichever ballot you would like. So for argument's sake, and I'm not saying you should do this, but I may or may not have done it because of these down ballot, county commissioner type races where there are no other party folks of other parties other than Republican on the ballot, it just really makes logical sense to choose the Republican ballot if you would like to vote for those candidates. That was what you need to do. So again, keep that in mind when you go vote. Now I'm going to play in its entirety the conversation that was held at the County Commissioner Candidate Forum.
Each unit is a multi-million-dollar business unit with multi-million-dollar budgets, payrolls. We've got 13 times we've got a very substantial business endeavor. But this does, and this is not to profit itself up, but it's to allow the citizens to know that my skill set has been for the last 30 years.
Let me pause it just a second. I believe this was David Hunt speaking at this point.
Dealing with large numbers, dealing with large budgets, and this is directly transferable to what we do in county government. We use large numbers, and in county government, I like this. We can't bring on the attorney. We have to meet our budget. We must plan our budgets. I'm not interested in raising taxes. As a matter of fact, this last year, we lowered the tax rate in response to the increase in property valuations that came. Most of this was property values increased due to the insurgents of people moving from other areas of the world. Many of them. I have a large skill set, financial budget compliance. And I do understand the difference between lots of needs. We have a lot of needs here in this county. We have a lot of needs for our sheriff's department. We have a lot of needs for the EMTs. We've got our county schools. I'm thrilled to say that tomorrow, and I was speaking earlier, I'm thrilled that the school board got a third party to come in and take a look at what we can do for the Rutherford County School System. What is it that we can do to better pay our teachers, to pay our assistants and coaches, the people that are frontline, that work with our children? This last year, our budget for the insurance department slightly exceeded that of the school system. It was, so the insurance department was the most fully funded, largely funded, their funds last year. Proud to say that we've hiring 3 new ambulances this coming year for our EMT. There's a discussion. We had a couple of things with our the COVID money that expires, but we have the opportunity to maybe buy 2 more additional for a total of 5 ambulances for our EMS this coming year. And probably I'll wait at the Q&A, but what I bring to the table is a lot of experience, 30 years of experience in business. I want to give back. I want to continue to give back. We are doing wonderful things for the county, and I'd like the opportunity to return this next year and for the next 4 years and do this work on behalf of Rutherford County and our citizens. Thank you very much.
I paused the recording for a second to give you a little bit more situational awareness. Here are some photos I took at the event and gives you the lay of the land. I wouldn't say it was sparsely attended, but there are roughly 50 people in attendance in addition to the candidates. So here's some photos from the event, and the candidates were up on really the altar. And this gentleman was the MC. Use the noises as the wind is knocking branches over outside. To give you some sense again of the scope of the county, if you live in Lake Lure, which is on the northwestern section where this was held, it was in the southeastern section of the county. As a journalist, I believe in fairness and accuracy, but a few photos do really tell a story and paint a picture of what actually happened. So you can see from this photo, the candidates, and there was some, I would say, back talk or not, you know, some more conversation pieces taking place. You'll see 2 of the candidates who are leaning back further. And then there was this candidate, Donnie Hawk, who has his hand raised with a microphone now. And he always brings up the budget and wanting to know more about the budget, which you'll hear about in more detail in a minute. But I did want to emphasize this was the situational awareness of the lay of the land of what was happening. I do wish I took video of it, but again, the internet was not cooperating for me to do so, unfortunately. And you can see from this picture some community members speaking with Sheriff Ellenberg here, if you can see my mouse over his shirt. And in the back row, there was another county commissioner, and I believe that was Jason Weiss sitting next to him, who ran unsuccessfully as a Democrat for sheriff. Again, some community members here, and Bryson Smith, the chairman of the Republican, Rutherford County Republican Party. And that was something else from another story, which I will share in another story about the congressional race. And this is Hunter Haynes, one of the candidates. So those are the photos from the event. And again, I apologize if there's any audio issues. So let me go back and finish sharing that with you.
My name is Greg Lovis. I'm currently a commissioner representing District 2. I'm 62 years old. About here tonight, Teresa. We've been married for 38 years. We have 2 children, Courtney Jenkins. She works at the church as a business that is devoted to serving the needs, special needs children. Her husband, Jared, is one of our pastors. We have been at the church. My son, Jared, is a strength coach at Lincoln University. He's going to get married to you, and we'll think a bit about that. I'm an ordained deacon. I'm in my 40th year of education. I've had leadership experiences in every school district in Rutherford County. I love and support for education regardless of whence it comes. I believe in school choice, but I also believe that public schools need to be in choice, and we need to make sure that we are offering a product in public schools that makes folks more cheap for that. I'm currently retired in 2014 with 30 years of experience, and I'm now in my 10th year in Spartanburg School District 1. I'm the director of Spartanburg Career Center. If you don't follow us on social media, please do. That is the one thing that I want in Rutherford County, probably more than anything else, if I could wait to come back in one. We need those opportunities to make sure that we're providing carpenters, electricians, welders, as well as those kids who want to be nurses and teachers. We serve all of those. But I think that's a great opportunity that we have in the county. And as commissioner, I would fully support the school board and anything that they're doing. Coincidentally, next Thursday, Senator Ted Budd is liaison, and I can't remember the gentleman's name, Western District Director for Senator Budd, will be at Swap, looking at workforce development and what we do there. And my hope and goal is that some federal money would flow to our local board of education, and there could be a North Carolina pilot program in Rutherford County for a career. So that's one thing I'd like to see. I think.
I'm going to pause this throughout just to give you some situational awareness. Again, Greg Lovelace is speaking right now, and he's discussing careers. Now, of course, there's the North Carolina Commerce Department and the Career Works, so I'm not sure if he's talking about something else in addition to that or if he's not aware of that, but there are programs that do exist for career placement in the county. However, as you'll hear, and my own personal opinion, Cops in Congress commentary, if I may add, is that there needs to be higher paying jobs in Rutherford County. It's just absolutely wild that some of these county jobs and other small businesses and larger businesses really just don't pay a basic livable wage. So that's certainly something to think about as you make your decision to vote, in my opinion.
It's very important. Finally, when I ran, start with and raising money on everything. I think it's very important that we have an educator on the committee. Yes, I manage a multi-million dollar budget every year. I'm my home school district. But I'm not the expert, maybe. These two gentlemen that left me are. With running many multi-million-dollar budgets. But I can promise you, I'm the most qualified that knows what schools need. And that is my passion, and that is the support that the schools are going to have.
Thank you, gentlemen. Appreciate that very much. Clearly, I elected to claim Henrietta First Baptist Church, I'm a user of the facility, and I'll pass over to Jamie Johnson, setting everything up. Pastor Jamie, sitting back in the back on the back row, where he hates to do this. So, we are really glad to be here and happy to be here. Disappointed, I don't have about four or five questions here. So if anybody's got a question you're holding on to, please bring it up, if you will. If you want to ask a question, pieces of paper here, if you want to come up. That was a question.
If you'd like to make a comment on your sheet of paper there, feel free to do so. If you'd like to sign your name, feel free to do so. Otherwise, we will just read them as they've done. And my beautiful wife, Jean, here is putting everything in order for me. She knows what a slob I am. So let's get to the first question. For those who are currently serving, what have you accomplished that benefits this part of the county in your 4 to 8 years on the board? And the second question is, for those that are running for the first time, what do you intend on doing that benefits the lower end of the county? Now, this is, I'm not a bit surprised to get quick. We feel seriously neglected out here sometimes. And so it's a valid question. And
That's David Hunt speaking, and just a programming note too, Mark Ledford, one of the commissioner candidates, has effectively dropped out of the race. I really apologize for the background noise on this. I was writing some questions down and my phone was nearby picking up the pen on the paper. So my apologies, but hopefully you can read through the transcript to understand what is being said. Thanks.
Down at the house, but then when that happens, then the county takes on the responsibilities and the cost of you taking it down the house, removing it, having it shipped away, and then disposing it properly. We have budgets, we have a lot of need for very real emergency services, you know, sheriff, the EMT, and that. And so it's a matter of we need to get after our landowners that upkeep and repair their buildings here, fail to put locks on them. This is a personal responsibility thing. If people own the property, they need to maintain it, put locks on it, prevent them from being turned into crash houses, if you will, for the persons to do drugs in there. But one thing that we have done is we've in the process of receiving the money from the lawsuits from the opioid addiction lawsuits, putting together rehabilitation programs, and that's many thousands of dollars that they're going into that. We've got other private firms like Out of the Ashes that do marvelous things, halfway houses, etc. I agree that we need to take a look, a sharper look at the southern end of the county. The needs are not all in the northern end of the county, not all in the county, but we do need help in this area of the world too. This is why we have a health station, some sheriff's office, and some smaller substations here. We built a new fire department here to help for the area in and around the Claiborne community, and that therefore then lowers the tax rates for fire protection, et cetera, for a lot of our city. But I'm glad to continue to work and to continue to answer my phone calls, continue to answer my emails, and be very responsive to that. I made that commitment to our citizens that I do answer the phone and invest my abilities. I do be diligent to try to get to 400 citizens, whether they be in District 3 or any of these districts.
I'm the longest serving sitting up here. Quite honestly.
Again, that's Greg Lovely speaking currently.
fully supported the EMS stations that was built here, supported the library. I met with several folks in the Cliffside as they looked at some reasons which really never came to fruition. Sadly, a lot of the things that happen are driven by the municipalities, and the municipalities are not here. They don't make it right, but that is kind of what's happened. Being at, between Chase High School and Chase Middle School for 23 years, there, I've been at home because I know the conditions that are in the community. I know the number of places that need to be cleaned, that need to be torn down, cleaned up. But then you get into the question of zoning. If you're going to have the authority for the county government to do that, then are you willing then to bite the bullet and accept the zoning which would be required? I can tell you that we are looking at the rail trail extending to Cliffside as well as to Ellenbrook. The rail trail, no county dollars are paid for the rail trail. So that is not anything that any tax money is going through. I think the original plan was that it would extend from Ankeny all the way to Cliffside. So that grant is being looked at now. My understanding is if, make sure I get my terminology right, there's a federal rail bank that basically older railroads, as long as they're included in that federal rail bank, then the original rail crew is still in existence. If that corridor has been taken out of the rail bank, then you have an issue of the property owner getting easement to go through their property. That is being investigated by the attorney now, as to what people will look there. The county planning department, and really a lot of this came about. There was a particular lady, and I don't know if she's here, and I wouldn't call her name if she was. Who I had meeting, they were concentrating the last spring, and I followed up basically from our conversation at that time to see, you know, the football piece at the baseball park in Cliffside. It was sitting there. And something needs to be done about it. So, working with the Foothills Regional Commission, we have secured a rural transportation grant that will basically enable us to update a land use plan and our economic development plan with particular focus south of 74. And once that grant is finalized, then the next step will be having community meetings in Avondale, Henrietta, Cliffside, and seeing what would the group of citizens like for the county to do with those funds to serve them. We're also, the official grant has not been submitted, but in initial conversations with Dogwood Health Grant, things look, we think, favorable, and that would be a comprehensive community assessment of just the former industrial communities of Cliffside, Henrietta, Carolina, and Avondale. And, you know, if you know of Dogwood, you know they have a lot of money, and they give out a lot of money. And so we are very hopeful that if we're able to secure that grant, that will be an additional means of resource that we can involve the community with on what, how to best utilize those funds for this particular area. I don't say the Lord, they said it's supposed to be.
Mayor, I believe the question would be, what would be proposed that we would do? What would be memory range button?
Well, those that are running for the first time, what do you intend on doing that benefits the lower end of the county?
All right.
I like southern end weather too.
Much.
times of worship. It's been proven time and time again.
This is Donnie Hawk now speaking.
In different places I've worked, and I've worked in some really rough places. Outside of Baltimore is one of the worst places I've ever worked. That if you clean up a community aesthetically, that it will raise hopes and it will raise morale of the community. That when you leave things blighted, when you leave broken windows, when you leave trash on the side of the road, that doesn't do anything but bring more trash to be thrown on the side of the road, to break more windows. I also know, being in the private business world my whole life, that I've yet to see any government entity of any kind be able to do anything as efficiently as private. And when you talk about doing public works projects, it's always been a pet peeve of mine that it will cost a county or state $2 million to build a restroom, but you can build a thing for $50,000. So I know that on the private side of industry, of what can be done for a lot less dollars than on the public side. What I don't know is if Rutherford County has any experience in public and private partnerships and making things happen. But I've worked with public and private partnerships in Mecklenburg County, in Charlotte, different places, and helping the community with policy, the recreation facilities, performance facilities, things like that. It can work. Also, the ability to take advantage of shifting the market and getting volunteers from the community to help do things here, and then supporting that volunteerism from the county side. Those are the things I would be looking at. Is there any public-private partnerships that have interest of the public and private monies to help do these things? Are there businesses around here that we can partner with? Are there other people around here that we can help? Are there things that we can do to attract businesses, to fund businesses, to come here and do things? Is there any kind of help that we can help do them? And so it's just an outside company coming in and making money off the county to make something happen. Are there local people that can help do this for less money? So those are the things that I would look at, trying to improve and improve the aesthetic. I've driven down through here for years and just look, and you've got beautiful. I mean, the river out here is gorgeous. It's beautiful. But then the things around it, not so much. So there's some things I think if we fix some of the aesthetic around, that it would attract some interest in doing some other things and other people to invest. And that's what we need. We need people to invest in this area of the county.
Well, Barry, my answer for this is not what I would.
This is Hunter Haynes now speaking.
Well, what I have been doing for this area of the county, I am young, but for the past at least 5 years, I've poured my soul into this end of the county. We get back to the side ballpark. The president takes over for a few years. I attempted to bring that back to what it was, and they had phone bills and my day pulled into us. But I would be lucky to get the county to come down there and turn the lights on for me for our games tonight. I've taken people down Main Street over here, taking care of this area. I've chased people under the bridge, arrested people out of the preacher's driveway over here. So for the past 5 years, I've tried my best in this area, and that is one reason that I'm running for commissioner, is to get back to this area that has been forgotten about for years, I believe. There's a few ways to go about fixing it, I believe. We need to bring businesses down here like they once was. This was a booming town. I saw pictures of this place that looked like Park City at one point. It was booming, and it was because of our jobs and our businesses down here. We also work with sheriff's office and help them out, put more guys on the road. We'd be more proactive down this way, and I think that'll solve a lot of the problems.
Thank you.
Just a quick programming note, too. For those of you who don't know, I'm mostly deaf, and Otter AI is a great tool, this program, this website and app that I use to transcribe speech. But it's technology. Technology isn't perfect, and it does not like Southern accents, I have found. So you'll see kind of weird things sometimes, like Call of Duty instead of what he said. So keep that in mind as we go through the conversation.
I will say that we're going to have to hasten on a little faster because
We are being inundated now with questions, and so we get right to it.
Several people, as he called for questions, several people did submit questions, so you'll see there were probably roughly 10 questions, I think, all told, including a few from me.
We have two county commissioners working out of the county and another one working out of state. My question is that with your travel time to and from your job, how much time do you spend on the county? And as a current commissioner, what have you done to improve the quality of jobs, keep people employed in the county, those that are hoping to be elected? What would you do to improve the employment here in our county? Some of this has been addressed, but we will start with, you still have a mic, correct? Okay. Why don't you answer what you would do in terms of better quality of jobs and those kinds of things?
Well, I think we need to increase our opportunities here for the business of this area especially. Going back to my answer just a second ago, at one time this area was booming, and we need to be proactive going out and finding jobs, and it starts with cleaning this area up and showing that we care about this area, getting it clean and attracting businesses to come down to the south end of the county.
And as I said, I mean, you're right, some of this was answered in a previous question about what we would do to change. It starts with jobs and making room for jobs. And there's always the question of, and you have the right work staff to do the job? Do you have workers? Do you have jobs? I feel like we attract the workers. We attract the job. We get the workers. So I think that to improve the southern end of the county, we need to have this end of the county was the first. I don't know, probably everybody lives here knows this was the first industrial site. The first industry that came to Rutherford County was here on the southern side in Henrietta. And it was the first. I mean, you were 10, 15 years ahead of any other place. There's no reason that we can't work to make that happen again. It's just when everybody left, there was no allocation for anything to make any changeover. So now we're 30 years into the Depression. We need to get out of it. And getting out of it means we need to bring jobs here. So I feel like that working really hard to bring jobs into this part of the county is the number one effort. I think that that solves the other problems. So I think that anything we can do to invite employers to be here, to help employers to be here, to be friendly to employers to be here, that's what we should be focused on.
Thank you, Don.
Well, you did the nail on the head here. I think jobs are very important, but how do we attract jobs to this county, to the southern end of the county? What we've done with economic development and with tourism development, association, what we've done there is, anybody been through Spindale or lately, seen the new signage and that, some of the new signage around the county, the brown signs that says, back to rent here. So this is a direct result of some of the work we've done on the TDA. I'm a member of ex officio on the TDA committee. We work with the economic development. This is all a hand-in-hand sort of a thing. If we can get the municipalities in this area of the world, you know, some of the town governments and work with the TDA and the Economic Development Authority, that then this is rather than they can be full, that allows us to not only unify the area, but also attract it and get jobs on this area of the world. We have the region. We've got a wonderful community. We've got a big space. Matter of fact, we have a good ministry in here. We're well down the road talking about getting another 1,000 feet on the runway of our airport. But it starts at the start. We need to get our municipalities involved, possibly even some of the volunteer groups, rails and trails. People are very interested in getting this rail trail extended. And that's part of what we do. And these are some of the commissioner duties that we take on in the smaller sub
committee groups, on the library board, the TDA, the BAC, and other boards as well. This is the work that we do outside of the commission, but the commission is working to bring jobs in, albeit through the other subcommittees here. I would love to see some dialogue with Henrietta, Kvostik, all of our little communities down here, that if we can get working a little bit stronger with the TDA and the economic development, I think we'd really be into something. And that's what I'll continue to work with as we move forward.
The way the economic development works, I know a lot of times it's like, we ain't doing nothing. You're not doing anything to attract any more jobs. Every month, the EDC gets a copy from the state, from the Department of Commerce. You get, these are the companies looking to locate in North Carolina. If you want to fill out the paperwork, they'll go to that company to get them to consider your location as a destination. So that's step one. Well, one of the first questions is, do you have interstate access? And that's a no for us. That is a major thing that new larger companies are looking for. Luckily, we have our local legislators on board as well as our federal. I look for 74 to have future interstate designation in the very near future. And, when that loop around Shelby is then complete and you've got a straight shot from 26 to 85, and they do a road widening work, especially the shoulders, I think, on 74, then we do have an interstate running through Rutherford County.
Let me pause for a second, just give you some context for those who don't follow this closely. Congressman Chuck Edwards did put forth legislation on the federal level to make Highway 74 what they call a federal highway or future interstate. Last I looked, that's in discussions with NCDOT and federal partners to make that a reality. I'm not sure what the time frame is on that. I have seen things dating back over 25 years discussing and connecting 26 and 85, what Greg Lovelace is describing. However, I don't know where that stands today on February 24, 2024. However, that Highway 74 designation is coming for, for any general purpose for those coming to the area. What they're talking about is companies coming to the area are going to look for those municipalities and counties that do have access to roads, to interstates. One can make the argument that 221 and 74 are pretty much like an interstate. However, they don't have those designations for various commerce purposes.
We have very few available shell buildings that fit what the current business market is looking for. Most shell buildings that we have in the county that are available do not have the ceiling height that is required for someone when we come in and take over an existing building. We've also had major businesses that were going to bring a lot of jobs, and this is stuff we can't divulge because we're sworn to secrecy, and legally you can't, but that have fallen apart when they're at the loan closing that was going to bring hundreds of jobs. And the two parties get in a disagreement, the business picks up and goes home. And there's nothing we can do about it. We're just as upset about it as anybody else would be.
Let me again pause for a moment to give you some context and interject what actually is a public record in North Carolina and what isn't. I won't say he's incorrect. However, I would say that there's a caveat to some of those discussions. When a business pulls out of a county, to my knowledge, there's nothing preventing county officials or public officials to release details of that and say, hey, look, X company was going to come here, but because of XYZ 1, 2, 3 reasons, they didn't decide to come here, because those would be lessons learned for future business and development. So just a brief caveat to what current Commissioner Greg Lovelace is stating.
Absolutely, we need the jobs, but I can tell you that I'm pushing all that I can to bring in as many new opportunities as we can.
Thank you, gentlemen.
I'm going to move on to the next part two. But this was a very interesting conversation for sure. So stay tuned while I share part two. What's really cool about Otter AI is it does give you an option, a summary of what was transcribed. So in part two, you'll see some of these headlines here discussing what is upcoming in what I'm about to share, but the conversation centered around public engagement and community development in various contexts. And you'll see those details and hear those details. Some of the action items coming from the conversation included providing the budget numbers and calculations in writing to people who asked about budget increases, coordinate the budget information clearly for each department, show how much of funding is actually being allocated, shop around for other waste management companies besides what is currently being used, look into convenience center hours to try to reopen on Wednesdays, following up with the county attorney regarding ABC law restrictions, and utilize the business incubator program at ICC to help with small business setups. So those are some highlights and the part two of the conversation.
This question starts with a comment. Attending a commissioner's meeting, citizens are given 3 minutes to address their issues to the board and to the commissioners. You do not only have to reply to the concerns. I find this being disrespectful, and they should be given an answer. If elected or reelected, what would you do to change this policy?
I voted for a 5 minute public comment. I voted for a 3. If anybody comes to a county commissioner meeting and you walk in and you tell this, that if you get there at 5:30, I'm sitting in the foyer. I agree to every person that comes in, and I will sit and discuss with you anything you want to discuss until about 3 minutes till 6 when they'll text me and say you got to come in. I respond to every telephone call. Anytime you look at discussing issues, I don't think anybody can tell you they have not been able to do so. I mean, I spent my whole life dealing with mad parents. And I mean, I knew when you're dealing with stuff that's important to you, somebody's going to be mad. I'm very willing to talk to that mad person. But if you have 15 public comments or 12, we've had 7 or 8 many times. And you go 5 minutes and then you get into a back and forth, it is very hard to get progress made, in my opinion. So I would probably not be in favor. I'd be fine going back 5 minutes, but I would not be in favor of going any longer than that. But my availability is there.
Funny you should mention that, Greg.
So that was Greg Lovelace just speaking, and now up is David Hunt. And they're discussing an open meetings law in North Carolina. It's a little murky as to what the open meetings law actually states in terms of length of time that a member of the public may speak. I'm looking into that more for an upcoming story, but that's the open meetings law, of course, for a public meeting is what they're discussing.
Career of dealing with customer complaints and doing the best I can with those too. So the idea of a little diplomacy and no tact when it comes to talking to people is very, very important. Every question is important. Every question needs to find an answer. Sometimes in the format that we have in the 3 minute comment, or I would be agreeable to a 5 minute comment session. We might not have the answers at our fingertips at that point, which is why it's important that email me, give me a call, let me know ahead of time so I can look for an answer for you. But the public comments do a lot of great things for us. It's an open forum by which people can air their concerns, air their viewpoints, and that this is America after all. You need to have a voice, you need to be heard.
But it comes down to looking for answers. We do occasionally need a lot more time being able to address this. I would love to have the public comments, but by definition right now, our charter says that we don't comment at the end of some of the comments because this then we set up a reply and back and forth even at the time of the meeting like that. I would far rather see either the 3-minute format or the 5-minute format. Love to see the citizens come up and have their concerns heard. So please follow up with me. Give me a call, give me an email. Probably email is going to be the best way because then with an email, we've got a digital copy. Then I can get this to the proper person that can answer the questions. And this puts it in the public domain so that we ever have a records request, we can show our due diligence and what it is that we do. It's very important that we do this. And I love the public comments. But there is reason to think that the responses just really don't make a lot of sense in the setting that we have there at the commission. Follow up with email and voice later. I'm your guy. I'll be there for it. Thank you.
So I'm not a guy that's ever afraid of a question. I'm not afraid of a conversation. And I do feel like time is time, you know. But I don't think there's any reason why you can't set up, say, 5 minutes is the time from question and answer and be able to go on the record with the answer and say it right there. So if there's a public comment that needs an answer, then put the answer and put it on the record. So I would be in favor of that because I like conversation. I like conversation.
That's Donnie Hawk speaking. Donnie Hawk has a interesting point, in my opinion, but going back to what was discussed by the other gentlemen, I don't believe in what was stated. I don't believe the current Rutherford County Charter allows for county commissioners to respond in the open meeting. It is a one-way public, in the public comment period. So keep that in mind as he continues.
And I think it's fine. It does show respect when you do answer. And you answer on the record, on video, in front of everybody. But I want to go back to a comment that Greg made about the economic development, getting a list and then pursuing a list. As a contractor, I could get those lists as well. And I found out 25 years ago that list is worthless. By the time that list is published, the answer has already been given. If, as a contractor, if I don't pursue the work before it's published, I don't get the work. I don't think, I'll go on record right here, I don't think our Economic Development Committee is doing a good job. We haven't brought jobs to the county. It's very obvious that we haven't brought jobs to the county. So the pressure needs to be made. And if you're sitting back waiting on this to be published, that's why we don't have jobs.
All right, so if I'm picking up what I believe your person's putting down here with a question, I don't think the question has been answered yet because I've been asked this 100 times since I've been running for commissioner. Why can the county commissioners, if I go up there and take my time to conversate with them, why can they not answer my questions? And I don't know the rules of why they can't because I'm not a commissioner yet, so I'm not going to sit here and tell you I do. But if I'm in there, I will do whatever's in my power to. Obviously, you can't go up there and you can't talk for 15, 20 minutes at a commissioner's meeting, but we're working for you. We deserve, or you deserve, for us to conversate with you with your concerns, and I will do everything I can to make that happen if I'm elected.
Thank you, gentlemen. Again, we need to be brief as we possibly can. This is an interesting question. Would you support a resolution to limit sleeping in cars? Lake Lure is working on an ordinance, this anti-dance. I have a feeling you'd need an ordinance along those lines about sleeping in cars. I don't know if there's a safety issue involved, but in any case, could you give me a quick answer on that?
So just some context, and when this question was posed, there was a woman sitting near that gentleman who just spoke, really visually and audibly gasping at sort of, you know, what a question. And I had just listened prior to attending this meeting to the February Lake Lore Town Council meeting where this issue was brought up, that it's under consideration in the town of Lake Lore. So some additional context on this.
I believe you're right. I believe that would have to be a county ordinance. Not against the law to sleep in your car as long as you're in a public place. But that could be something we could look at. There need to be regulations on it. Obviously, you can't go out here and park on the side of the road and just sleep. So I wouldn't be opposed to looking at an ordinance for that.
To me, there has to be a lot more definition. You know, pulling off on the side of the road, you're tired, pulling the rest stop, sleep in the car. If you're sleeping in a parking lot or sometimes it's property, I think it has to be some guidelines. I would have to look into it and understand, you know, naturally, I don't want somebody pulling in my driveway and just going to sleep. You know, so there's other things around that that I would have to look into before I would say, because I've been that tired person driving myself and pulling to a rest stop, take a nap. I think that's fine. So I guess there's other things around it that I would have to look into to be able to understand that better, whether or not the, what type of ordinance it would need to be.
Thank you. Well, like Donnie, I have occasionally taken long road trips and found myself in a rest area that I have taken a nap in my car, especially on some of these really, really long trips. But in the same vein here, we have to define what it is that we're looking at. It needs to be narrowed down. Public space, rest areas, Walmart allows campers to park on their property away from the buildings there. Does that constitute a car? No, but it is a vehicle of sorts. It bears taking a look at, and this goes back to due diligence. I'd be very open to looking into it and seeing what it would look like. But at the end of the day, it comes down to enforceability as well. You know, where are these areas? What does that look like? So I think the first step there would be, yes, I wouldn't mind looking into it, but I'm not about to say, yes, we would do that because we're not in business putting the cart before the horse. Let's take a look at it and see what it shapes up like.
I would not be opposed to looking at it. I would want advice of our attorney as to what the parameters are, that are good to do, what good policy, and then we'd vote from that point.
Thank you, Doug. In the interest of full disclosure, my name is Thomas Crawford, and I'm running for the school board. The safety of our students will be my number one priority. We're currently 4 school resource officers short. As a commissioner, are you willing to fund, in part, the SRO positions?
Yes.
That's the best. I like that answer. Yes. Yes, I would stand behind that. I think our children need to have SROs in the school. I think it's very, very important. Yes,
even if we had to look at budgets and make sure that other monies move around, I think that would be a priority. Yeah. So I'm big on priorities, and that would be a priority.
Yes, that's the number one priority, and I believe we're late on doing so.
Totally agree. Thank you, gentlemen. This is rather long. I noticed in the paper it was stated that from 2022 budget to present, the Sheriff's Department has been given a 17% increase, and the Detention Center has been given a 27% increase as well. Looking at the 2022 budget, the 2024 budget, it looks like only 2.43%. increase was given to the Sheriff's Office. Looking at the Detention Center, it looks like only 7.33%. Can you please explain how or where the money is, if it's a tax? I'm not sure what that last word, payment. Taxpayer cut, see proof in the budget, once it's proof in the budget. I think the 17% and so forth was relative to Deputy Salas, as I recall.
That's what I recall as well.
Thank you. 17% was from 22 till this year. It's a 2-year raise. That's for the 17% game.
Does anyone else want to address that? If the person that asked the question will see me afterwards, I'd like to get your email address and make sure you have in writing from the county the information that you're asking.
So I've got a question about it as well. I've got the budget in front of me. And it is public information.
When Johnny Hawk said this, I have to make a point of stating what I witnessed. David Hunt, who was speaking, who was sitting to Johnny Hawk's right, but if you're facing the stage in that picture, you'll see David was sitting to the left of Johnny. David, when Donnie just said this, David's hand sort of raised and not quite fully up in the air, but it was a visual depiction, I think, of the frustration that is surrounding this issue. So keep that in mind.
Budgets. And the numbers don't add up. The budget is very, very confusing. One of the first things that I would do is get the accounting department to coordinate, correlate information to the departments. So it's very easy to see how much goes to the sheriff, how much goes to the school, how much goes to the EMS. And then it's much more easy to then prioritize the things. Right now, it's 168 pages, and it's scattered throughout. It's very unclear. And in having conversations with different financial people in different departments, because I'm trying to figure out priorities. I've been working on this for 3 weeks. I've got a list of questions. I've got a list of calculations, and nothing adds up to anywhere close to the percentages that were published, not even close. But that is a big concern that I have, is that we understand that anybody can download the budget and is written in such a way that everybody knows exactly where the dollars are going, because it makes you very suspicious when everything is just kind of spread around 168 pages. It should be very clear.
Can I get a question from you one more time, Gary, if you don't mind?
No question, actually. I'm going to summarize. They said that there was a difference in the budget stated in the newspaper, a 17% increase, and the detention center had a 27% increase as well. But the overall budget, the increases were very, very smaller. Only 2.43%, they say, on the sheriff's office, and 7.33% on the detention center. Can you please explain why or where the money is if, as a taxpayer, can't see proof in the budget?
So I can't explain the second part because I'm not up there yet. But I can tell you that I lived that and I received that paycheck, and along with a lot of other emergency services and deputies in the county, and this is a big part of why we are losing highly qualified people to other counties. I can promise you, from my paycheck, from 2022 to even now, it was not 17%. I would say it's probably about 3%. And that is why I feel like we're losing a lot of deputies and why we're in the shape we're in at this point.
And I think it's fair to say, and I would like to just take plain numbers. Forget the percentages, because people can play with the percentages. It's very easy to do math differently. I call it language math. And getting creative with percentages. Let's give it a hard dollar. It went up $200,000. It went up $50,000. So that anybody can see it, it's a clear thing whether it went up or down.
That's exactly right. And the one comment I make is that lower than any of the surrounding counties, including even Polk County, which is much smaller. So I think that's important to remember. The next question is, do you support reopening the county convention center on Wednesdays? Oh, convention center, I'm sorry. I was going to say, I didn't know we had convention. 6 a.m. to 6 p.m. seems long to many people. I've had to perhaps change hours, but have options every day except closed on Sunday. Any
I'll go ahead and field this.
I started we have to open on Wednesday.
We've got budgets. The tipping fees, the wages there, they went up. Our tipping, our transfer station up in Rutherford, all those fees for shipping me down to South Carolina, those went up. And it was a matter of, do we close convenience centers for one day a week? And that ended up being on a Wednesday, or do we keep them open and increase taxes? What we had was a revenue neutral budget this last year, and decisions had to be made that it was either that or else go up on the rates for tipping. And it ended up that it seemed to be the most economical solution that we shut it down on Wednesday. Now, I know this doesn't make everybody happy, but there are some people in the county that Wednesday was really indicated that it could happen. I feel badly for them. It's too bad. But at the end of the day, we want to do the most good for the greatest amount of people and not raise the taxes here in Rutherford County. Because otherwise, and apply taxes to where the tipping fees, where you would bring your goods or your refuse and pay more per ton. This was a tough decision to make. And straight answer is, yeah, I'd like to open them on Wednesdays, but how are we going to pay for it? Are we going to charge people more? Are we going to, you know, ship from some other department badly needed dollars? No, I think Wednesdays closed was the best solution for the greatest amount of people in this county.
Basically, solid waste operates as an enterprise fund, which means that it has to be self-sustaining. The money that's coming in has to pay for the expenses. The state allows waste haulers, you know, we had a contract with Republic Services. And Republic Services, due to their diesel increase as well as their cost of doing business increase, they said we need a 24 or 26% increase mid-year of the contract, in the middle of the contract, informed us this is, your fee is going to increase this much percentage-wise. And I don't remember what the exact dollar figure is. But basically, our folks were able, the solid work of the solid waste, were able to get it down to 11-point-something% for the increase, negotiated it down. And that has to come, it's not something that you can strike a check out of county money and pay for. It has to be paid for out of what's coming in to the facility because it's an enterprise fund. So the only option then is, you know, the decision was made for the remainder of that budget year that by closing on Wednesdays, then that would cut the expenses so that we could pay for the inflated amount of the contract. At that point, rather than increasing all of the expenses that citizens pay for this fiscal year in order for the enterprise fund to break even to be open on Wednesdays, I voted for it not to be open.
So I don't know, you know, I wasn't involved with the contract, but it sounds like the contract was broken.
The state allows it. In this case, that's one of the very few cases, and it might be the most
important. Yeah. Yeah, I would definitely be shopping for other companies to take care of it.
There would be only one better service.
Yeah, they're much higher. The fees here that I pay in Park City, I've gone through to look into it twice what I pay in Mecklenburg County and Charlotte. There's got to be a ways to work on that.
So to answer your question, at this point, really all I can do in my job while I'm running to be elected or running for election is to listen to the concerns of the community. And from what I've heard, the concern is people feel their taxes went up and things like the convenience center being taken away on Wednesday is taken away. Now, every time you need to take your trash off, it's on Wednesday.
Do I think it's high priority? No, I don't. But I do think it's something we should look at and try to get a resolution fixed.
Thank you, all. Are you for or against county-wide zoning, and why? Like 100.
I'm not going to say I'm for it. I'm not going to say I'm against it. There is instance I think it could be good. There's also other instances where I'm not for it.
I'm against it. I've been in freedoms. I'm against it. I hate regulation.
At this point, I don't think it's a good idea that we look in too far into zoning and ordinances. However, there is a point to be made with noise ordinances, other land use ordinances. You want a big farm that can move right in next door to your house. I think it's coming off in the future. I think you're going to see some push towards that. But now, every time you have a noise ordinance or a dangerous dog ordinance, it comes down to enforceability too. The law has to be written, or the ordinance has to be written correctly. And because it's the county, this means the sheriff has to provide enforcement personnel. And we're already at a profile now where we have a request currently of, what is it, 14 new officers? Is that right, Sheriff? So we're looking at this. If you're going to put an ordinance in or a land use enforceable vehicle like that, you're going to have to spend a lot of time with the sheriff's department or animal control. Those are very real dollars that would have to be spent, a lot of salaries. At the end of the day, where does that money come from? It comes by either bringing more business and industry in or raising taxes. Do we want to spend $1,114,000 for more officers? Or do we take a look at maybe out in the future do that? So if my answer right now is no, I don't want ordinances that are going to eat up time. But then again, there are times I wish my neighbor's dog and just shut up.
Yeah.
But it is reality.
Though it would make my life better at times, I'm against any zoning.
I can tell you from what I've seen in the past, it's pretty much a dead issue in Rutherford County with voters. Why can only within city limits sell alcoholic beverages when the county would benefit from the revenue?
I'll be honest with you, I have no idea.
I have no idea how ABC laws are structured. I agree that if you had ABC stores in the county, that there could be revenue to be made, but I have no answer as to what that would be a question you put to Richard Williams, our county attorney. So that's as good an answer as I get.
I think the question is more concerning being able to sell beer and things in convenience stores. I think that's more, not necessarily an ABC store.
Right.
And I have no problem because right now the ordinances in the cities allow that to happen. And so it means that the convenience stores that aren't in the municipality cannot. And I know Calvin Golden Valley Sunshine, Becky's, can't, where Yogi's, which is 3 miles from there, can because they've got a special permission because they're called a resort because they bought a horse but the pasture and made the resort. So they can sell beer, so the horse is very valuable to Yogi's. And I think those loopholes like that are kind of crazy and that people have to go to that extent to be able to do it. I don't have an issue with the county making it so that our convenience stores, which are rare out in these areas, have the ability to make a little bit more money and hopefully stay in business.
As far as an election goes, probably not the best thing for me to say, but I don't think it would be all bad. I do think there's money to be made for it. And a big part of what I look at is a safety standpoint. People are going to
they want to drink beer, they want to go to the store and drink beer, they're going to drink beer. They're going to go to that pool, whether it can park here, whether it can go without. From a safety standpoint, I think it would be a good thing because people from Gold Valley can go to Beckett and get it rather than driving down Boston Center out to the corner store and possibly getting in a wreck. So I do think we could look at it.
That's really interesting to me because I primarily cover crime with my Cops in Congress newsletter. So I think Hunter Haynes made a great point there that where the safety component of why would you drive 5 miles when you could go much, much closer to get it, because if you want it, you're going to get it somehow, in my opinion.
This is regarding the Thermal Belt Rail Trail. The current agreement is a lease for 99 years. My understanding, there is a county match, tourism dollars on the majority of it. Would you support tax dollars funding the rail trail if needed? And now, or I guess maybe how, any benefit?
From what I heard from Mr. Lovelace over there, no county tax dollars need to be spent on that. And if that's the case, I say we go that route where we do not have to spend any kind of money on it. But I do think the roads and trails out this way would be a great thing.
Okay. As far as the county commissioner answered to that, I would say no, because I think this fund should be raised through tourism in some way.
Agreed. This is a project that has been put forward by the TDA. It's a great project. We've got the Rails for Trails property. Jerry Stensman is chairing that. They've done a fine job so far putting it all together. So, no, I don't think that we need to put any tax dollars into the rail trail.
And I'm going to clarify that we do not put, the tax dollars that you pay into it. Several years ago, we passed the quarter cent sales tax, or occupancy tax, which is basically designed for bed and breakfast, the hotels and all. People are coming in, they're visiting, then there is a quarter cent tax that goes to TDA. But that is not a tax that we put on the citizens, but those that are visiting are putting that tax. That's how the TDA is being funded. Theoretically, with tax dollars that are raised in the county, but it is not tax dollars we're taking from citizens. The TDA, along with the Dogwood and all those other foundations, or a child agency, maybe, are going to be.
Let me pause a second to give you some more context about the Thermal Belt Rail Trail. I don't know why they don't use the proper name. It's called the Thermal Belt Rail Trail. It's been around for several years, so for people to keep referring to it as a name that's not its name is a little strange to me as a journalist and as a taxpayer, in my opinion, but keep that in mind. And there's many different components to that. Certainly the Tourism Development Authority, the TDA, and the Foothills Regional Commission, and the nonprofit partners, including the Rutherford Outdoor Coalition. But the main funding from at least the first round, what created the initial Thermal Belt Rail Trail was an RHI Legacy Foundation. I don't want to call it a grant. I think it was maybe a grant, but it was through those partnerships with all of those groups. So it's a very complex topic to give you some more situational awareness for the possible continuation of the Thermal Belt Rail Trail in the southeastern part of Rutherford County.
What are you doing to help small business startups in the county? They have three questions. I'll possibly start with that one.
I know that a lot of the business startups that qualify for different matching grants, they are a lot of opportunities that we are able to help them with the, at the state level. And then there are some, depending on if you meet the milestones of the jobs that are created, then there is a tax reduction for a short period of time. But that has been my experience as far as small business goes.
The grant that just gone through, and the exciting news with the Isothermal Community College, with our new Walter Dalton building that we have out there, it's Youth Energy has moved in out there. We've got some nice platforms. But one of the sections out there is, and this comes as my, I'm a member of the Board of Trustees there at the college. We've initiated a program of business incubators so that we have one of our local, well, I don't need to disclose exactly what business it is, but it's to help get these small businesses off the ground, and with the caveat that the small business has no other local competitor anywhere within, I think it's a 60-mile range, so that it's a unique business that Isothermal Community College is thank you, Greg. All of that plus some very good news from Isothermal Community College. Great stuff.
So I've started businesses, bought businesses, sold businesses. I've never had any help from the government or the county to do any of that. What I would like is for them not to get in the way of me doing that. One of the reasons I'm running is because of the over-regulation that is in place right now. This thing that we're doing called change of use, if you're not aware of it, have we got any business people in here? It is terrible. It is horrible. The things that you have to do to meet the change of use, depending on who your code official is, coming to look at your land and telling you what you have to do with your parking lot, with your roofs, with your parking, with your trees. There's a business that I met in the process of doing interviews that wanted to rent another space. They've already been in business for 15 years, but they wanted to rent another space to another person to help share the load of their taxes and their burden for doing business. And because they were going to bring in another renter in the building that they were still in, the change of use authority came in Forest City and told them they had to do $100,000 worth of work to the parking lot. It would take this business owner maybe 20 years to see that $100,000 come back from a little bit of rent that they'll get from a person coming in because they've applied the change of use to her. Those are the things that we don't need to be doing to help businesses to be here. So there's one thing about ICC and incubators, and listen, I don't have a problem with it. I've never used it. I have a problem with the onerous regulation and code enforcement over businesses that are trying to grow and expand and have issues with the county doing it. That'd be where I've got the problem. If we can just back off of that, let people that want to be entrepreneurs, and then help them and advise them, maybe there's some decent advisory that can be going on to help from the college and from retired business owners who do it in Charlotte. I've been on the board with 3 different interviews and ask the questions freely. It's a give back. It's kind of like being a community. It's a give back. And so it's one of those things that young entrepreneurs can ask retired entrepreneurs how many things happen. I'm for that. That's a volunteer program. Doesn't cost anybody anything. It's just a greater good. But I am against all this regulation that we've got. It really hurts anybody to do the business at all.
I have a question. The change of use.
Yeah.
Is that the town of Forest City?
It's a statewide thing. It's all in. So let's talk about it. So I asked the sheriff a question. Whenever I first started running. Do you give a ticket to everybody that you can give a ticket to?
He said no.
He said no. That's exactly what I'm talking about on code enforcement. The code enforcement is so strong right now, and the application of change of use is just crazy that if the county or any of these municipalities wanted to, they could shut a business down. They could just shut it down and make it up to where it came up because the laws and regulations put up down there. I'm saying that code enforcement should not be allowed to do that, just like the sheriff would not allow his officers just to pick on somebody and ticket them for everything that they can ticket for.
But you would agree that state law has to be.
State law, just like President Biden, should be enforcing the border. He picks and chooses what he wants to enforce. The state can pick and choose what they want to enforce. I'm saying that picking and choosing and picking all entrepreneurs and people who want to expand their businesses is wrong.
We have two candidates for county office, I mean, for state office here tonight, and I'm sure they're interested to hear
that. And I've talked with both of them about it. I'm intense about this. I've interviewed one of them and got him on video to say that he would help me.
So that's why they put those videos.
That's it. My whole defeat in the fire.
I'm glad I didn't make any promises.
I think it's pretty well been answered. I'm going to piggyback off of Donnie. I believe small business owners are going to be left alone. I think as a commissioner, we should help them rather than hinder them get these small businesses started. And I think that should be high on our priority list. If a small business in Rutherford County is successful, if Bo Robertson is successful, if Serendipity is successful, and they're making money, they're going to spend money in Rutherford County. And like I said, I think that should be high on our priority list.
We don't make taxes off of these people, these inspectors shutting everything down. There's no taxes off of not expanding the business.
Let me interject for a moment and give some context to what was being discussed with this change of use. That is a state law, and I'll read some interesting facts about that in just a moment. But it is a statewide law. It's based off of building code. So buildings and sites are designed and constructed to comply with state and local regulations for their intended use and occupancy. So the UDO, the Unified Development Ordinance that a certain city has, is what is being discussed. The county, I believe, has something similar, but what Donnie Hawk was discussing is specific to Forest City. So keep that in mind. And it is a North Carolina State Building Code Ordinance. It has to do with, you know, the number of people you can have in the building, the safety surrounding that. But as in my opinion, I agree with parts of what he was talking about, and you know, not making it such a burden to a potential business owner to make changes to a building. However, you do have to keep in mind, you know, keep obeying the laws of the state too, and where that balance can be met is a challenge.
Yeah, that is. What can you do about the homeless problem? Please, don't take that.
So the question is, what can we do about the homeless problem? Well, get to the root of the problem first. Why do we have homeless? It's a matter of not health. This is what we're finding in some of the larger cities. Some of the mental health issues. They're turned out of some of the facilities that are there to help people along and help them re-engage into society. I'm a veteran myself. It's my heart to think that fellow servicemen are not on the street or living under a bridge, and that there's a lot of VA programs that are involved with helping veterans get back on their feet. Similarly, we have groups here in the county that deal with this too. But what it comes down to is what government needs to take a little bit of a back seat to encouragement of our churches. This is historically a function of the churches, helping our citizens, helping our church members, and this is part of what Out of the Ashes does to the industry. They take these people and pull them in, and I would think that volunteerism and more stress for us as individuals needs to be addressed. That we are a kind and giving society. This is a great county to live in, but is the matter of mental health or again, back to our previous discussion on drug abuse. You know, we have a lot of people that spend all the money put towards drug abuse, and these are some of the people that find themselves in some of our derelict structures out here as well. It's a large problem, and I think start at the grassroots. You know, what is it that can do as volunteer to start making more of these and moving forward with this?
I think drug use contributes to our homeless problem. I think mental health. I'm hopeful that with the opioid funds that are coming in, we can have a detox and rehab facility in one roof. I think we'll address some of that. But you know, Jesus said, I didn't come for people that's well, not the physician. I've come for the one poor physician. And I think as a church, we have an obligation. My church took some of that working with homeless women, but we don't do enough. And I think that probably most churches would tell me that they don't do enough. And I do think that is something that we as Christians, if we do what God may do, we do justify.
So, might ruffle some feathers here. We throw around this phrase, separation of church and state. What that means is that the state cannot tell you that you're going to be a Baptist. It doesn't mean that the county or the state can't help a ministry that's doing a greater good. I would be all for looking to see what we could do as a county to help a ministry. And I know people throw that church and state up whenever you say that. Like, Out of the Ashes is completely funded without any county money. Correct?
Correct.
No county money. I think that if we see a ministry doing a great good, and we honor that, and we can help them somehow, however that would be, it would be something we should look at. And there are 305 churches. When we were doing the Clive Newman Crusades here in Rutherford County quite a few years ago, my father-in-law, O.A. Fish, made it his personal mission to get all the pastors and their names and their phone numbers. And there's 305. Another thing that we could do on the county side is encourage these guys to get together, because if you got 305 churches working together, then it's not a burden for 12 churches. It's less of a burden if we can get them all talking together. So that would be a goal of mine, is trying to get pastors together, get them together, meet once a quarter, and just have discussions and maybe get them involved in this ministry together and share the burden a little bit, make it easier, but have all the churches involved.
So I feel that homelessness is a huge part of a lot of our issues in Russell County. The ones that won't help, I think we should help them, like Johnny said, and we should help places like Out of the Ashes that are doing great things. And they do help a lot of people that won't help. But just being honest, a lot of times it's a revolving door. They'll go there, they'll come out, and they're right back on the streets, and they're back to the drugs. And I know this area sees it a lot. I mean, you can't drive through here at nighttime. I work night shift. Close what happens. You better be careful. You might hit somebody. Just being honest. So I think going back to vision, if we bring businesses to the county, I think the ones that are wanting to do better, I think that would be a help for them because they'll have jobs to go to get off the streets. And another thing is, it's not illegal to be homeless. So you don't just come into that issue. We have to work with our state guys to kind of find a resolution for that. But I do think we should put in the places like Out of the Ashes that are willing to help and that are doing a great job of help.
We have basic ministries here in Henrietta, and I can tell you that the vast majority of homeless people that were addicted, we have a vast experience of that. We can help them weekly. But all we can do is provide food, clothing, shelter, not shelter, but food, clothing, hygiene products, things of that nature, to keep them alive. What they need is a cure. And it's a challenge. It's a challenge. And one of the things that the Sheriff's Department is doing a great job is taking some of these drugs off the street. The more that they can take off the street, the more the expensive they come. Some of these folks are going to be forced, you know, to go out, simply because of the cost. That leads me to the next question, funding for law enforcement. And we have discussed that a little bit. If anybody has anything you'd like to add
to what they would propose to do or what they have done, et cetera. So feel free to go right ahead. Sergeant Blake.
So, money wise, I would like, hopefully, if I get in there, Commissioner, I would love to take a look at the budget. I can't sit up here and tell you what I would do, because I can't make promises until I get in there and see it. But I think you guys down this way can agree that, and I do think y'all back the blue, y'all back law enforcement, support law enforcement, and I believe y'all are 100% in agreement that that is one of our main priorities. My slogan for my campaign, I don't know if you saw it, is strong at home. So, and that means we need to be strong right here in Rutherford County where we live. And the first part of being strong at home is to get out of the girl to take care of us, not only law enforcement, but our EMS, our fire. So I'm all for as much funding as we can get for law enforcement, for EMS and fire.
Unique perspective that I've had in the last 3 weeks. I've done 20 interviews with business leaders, pastors, community leaders, entrepreneurs, restaurateurs, just a lot of different people. And I asked them this question. If the money was yours and you had three things that you could spend the money on, give you the first priority, the second priority, and the third priority. If you watch these videos, you'll see the first priority with most everybody in the county is safety. So I would make sure that the county budget matched the priorities that the people in the county wanted it to be.
Great. Priorities in the county here. Safety is number one. A very, very close second would be education of our children and safety of our children as well. And then your services. As far as funding your law enforcement, we understand how important the sheriff and all the police departments and municipalities are. We understand the desperate need for having this. Just this last year, in 2022-23, we purchased 15 squad cars, 9 more this year, and we've got 4 additional squad cars on order right now for a total of 28 cars, new vehicles that we can use to put into road service. That's wonderful. These are resources that I'm happy to say that we voted and are able to provide and move forward here with the law enforcement. Yes, we do need to pay our sheriff's police more. What's happened, what we've seen, the kind of a cascade effect. Mecklenburg needs officers. They then come out to Gaston County. Gaston County gets poached. Gaston County then comes over to the next town, and so on and so forth. And this is where the poaching is. We've lost officers to Shelby and Gaston because of the fact that they can't get paid more. Same thing with Polk County. They have to compete with Henderson County and Gaston. This is how we lose our people. This is where we're going to have to find a solution. Is it taxes? Well, that is one solution. Do we diminish the funding for other departments? I hope not. We can look for efficiencies every single year. I think our efficiencies and our return on our investments that we make in our different departments are what they need to be. We need to attract more businesses, better businesses, bigger, larger payrolls into this county. It starts with us and we clean up our active county for money and to be able to attract more new businesses in because with larger tax base, we can shift a lot of businesses. I'm all about that. Every budget cycle, every time that we have a conversation, not only with our beloved sheriff here and chief deputy and detention officers, we're trying to look for ways that we can expand funding for the state of our citizens. We have a fair amount of we have to lead into budgets. With conversation, open communication between all of the members and all of our departments is where we plan to be. And this is pretty much a tough part of administration. But
that's where we are. And yeah, that's what I bring to the table. It's some business savvy. But I'd love to be able to work out and see what we need to do.
I will support additional funding.
Brevity. I like the brevity. Some of you may recall that the official Rutherford County Government Facebook page used to have the ability to public comment where the First Amendment and best practices for open two-way communication between government officials and the public. Last February, journalists asked a question about low salaries in a Facebook comment in response to a posted job requiring a part-time CDL paying less than $14 an hour on their official page. It wasn't addressed, and in the next post and subsequent posts to date, do not allow public comment, e.g. a limited public forum. If elected or re-elected, would you support reversing that by resolution and direct county staff to open the comments? And if not, why? Thank you.
I wasn't aware of it. Comment weren't allowed. I don't have a problem with comments. Mm-hmm. I don't think the resolution missed it. I was not aware that had been turned off. I never go to the county Facebook page. Only most of my interactions, folks talk to me and give me a call or messaging me on my Facebook page. I don't have a problem with that. Things on there. It doesn't require a resolution. It just requires direction from the county commissioner to the county manager that this is what we're going to do.
Right there, we do. I was not aware that comments were removed from the county Facebook page, but I think a valuable resource. I would move that commissioners direct our county manager to have that turned back on. I think feedback is a gift, and if you don't already have it, if you hear it, you can't fix it. Feedback is a gift.
As long as it's clean, you know, not personally, you know, attacking employees or anything like that, I have no issue with it. I think you can see that from my Facebook page.
I agree. I have no issues with it. And I'm also not going to put that on these guys. I doubt they probably have access to the county Facebook page or knew anything about it. But I believe in transparency, and I believe that if you want to make a comment, the comments should be accurate.
I totally agree. I agree with Mr. Howick that we should moderate the comments.
I was going to ask that, so may I just clarify that the comments were turned off, and my understanding is considered a limited public forum, but there's been times when that's been turned off for one post and reopened for another. So I think there needs to be consistency across the board of that. So I appreciate the current commissioners saying they're not aware of it. However, that brings up other questions. Thank you.
The second question was, do you support higher pay in the county employees? If not, why?
Yes. I think it should be a competitive wage, so it needs to be evaluated for what they're doing.
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we've done a competitive cost study a couple of years ago for all county employees, and I think we've got to, you got to keep your people. And at least address it in the legendary department.
Thank you, gentlemen, and appreciate it very much. Appreciate all the good questions. And I'm sure that you folks would be happy to share your contact information. If anyone has further questions or other comments toward you, feel free to do that. And so it's 8 o'clock, and I hope we can finish this up in about an hour and a half. And it appears we have, despite everything else, we've succeeded. But thank you again.
Thank you.
Thank you to Barry Yelton for emceeing that event, and thank you for watching. Please subscribe to anniedance.substack.com for the latest information and news about police and policy issues in Lake Lore, Rutherford County, and beyond.